7.
Well, hello everyone, this is Data Driven Chat, and today I'm very happy to introduce Vijay Praveen Maharajan, who is a data storyteller, TEDx speaker, 40 under 40 data scientist award in India. He is also a content creator. He is also on a top data scientist list at AI Time magazine. So he's a very, very highly decorated data scientist. Hello, Vijay.
Hello, Gana. Thanks a lot for your time and the schedule.
Thank you so much for making the time.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks a lot.
Just to kick off our discussion, the first question that I would like to ask you, if you could tell us a little bit about your journey as a data scientist. How did you become interested in data science?
That's indeed a nice question to start with. I did my bachelor's in electronics and instrumentation engineering from Congo Engineering College back in India. And then I traveled to the West, to Germany, to do my master's. So I did my master's again in electronics, but this time that is with the Technical University of Munich. And then I realized that I cannot be a good engineer. So during my second semester, I got a work student opportunity from Telefonica, Germany. And then I did my internship there. I also did my master thesis there, where I got some really good grades. And over a period of time, I also took some optional subjects at my university. So these things, they catapulted me into the data science. So from there on, the journey kept going. So I just kept going, and I'm really happy to be talking to you today in this webinar, Gana.
Thank you so much. So would you say that you mostly, I just want to kind of unpack a little bit what you said. Would you say that your journey started from education, but did you have to solve some real world problems along the way, or was it mostly educational path that you followed? Because, you know, different people have different experiences. So some say, oh, you know, I just got into solving a lot of problems, and others say I mostly progressed through education. So would you say that your path was mostly educational or mostly kind of practice problem solving?
Yes. So in my case, as you can see, I am from an electronics engineering background. So that has... to be honest, that has nothing to do with data science domain. So my case, it's more of a practical experience. Mm-hmm. So I was asked to support a data science team at Telefonica a few years back. And I was astonished. I mean, like whatever things that I was able to do at that time with that data, it aroused my interest. And that's how I got into it. And then I kept on doing one after the other. And as time went, it just got to me. And I was also in parallel coping it up with a few of the subject matters from the university and the internship and the master thesis. Those things, they actually gelled together.
So you are highly decorated data scientist, so you have all these awards, you are on all sorts of lists. I'm sure that I missed several titles. But looking back, if you had to pick one most important thing that you're particularly proud of in your career, what would it be?
For sure, that should be my TEDx talk, Gana. Mm-hmm. Because I mean, like as you said, I mean, like I'm not a decorated data scientist, first of all. So I mean, like these are things that comes along your way when you do things right. So I was actually invited as a guest speaker in a couple of international conferences last year. Mm-hmm. So that paved me a way to do a TEDx talk at TEDx Degendorf in November last year. Mm-hmm. The video got released in January 2020. I mean, like it's already doing good in social media platforms. It has already crossed 70,000 views, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And the good thing about TEDx talk is it's again about data. So I have thrown in a lot of stats, thrown in a lot of data about India.
Mm-hmm.
So in my opinion, you should watch it. You should.
Yeah, we will definitely make the link to your TEDx video. But can you in a nutshell, can you give us an elevator pitch for what you said in your talk?
So yeah, I mean, I've talked a lot about data. I've thrown in a lot of stats about India, in particular with pollution and the women being not given an equal importance to men in India. So a lot about data and the scenario back in India.
Yeah, so if you want to know, I'm just talking to our listeners, if you want to know find out about the issues related to economic development and how data science and AI could solve these issues in developing countries, that's definitely a great talk to listen to. So we will give the link to that, so you can check it out. So tell us, what are you currently working on? What keeps you awake at night? What makes you excited?
So I'm currently working on some of the cool accelerator projects. I mean, those projects are real world rail projects at Siemens, like predicting the delays, component failure prediction of train components. So from a business perspective, so I work more towards the visualization side.
Mm-hmm.
As you said, I'm a data storyteller, so I'm good at visualizing the data. And also, apart from the official projects, I'm also working on a couple of cool analytics projects that could be helpful for the Indian government in solving a couple of crucial headaches. So yeah, that the hunger or the thirst to do more is actually keeping me awake at night.
So this is very exciting. So we actually haven't discussed much data storytelling in the podcasts. So can you, for people who will listen, some of them are students and some of them are executive students, can you basically elaborate on what data storytelling is, just for people who haven't heard about the concept before?
Mm-hmm. So in my case, as I said, I build stories one after the other. So if I get a lead, I build a story. And if I get the next one, I'll build upon the story.
Mm-hmm.
So from a business perspective, you always need to have a broader perspective. You always need to have an eagle eye view so that it reaches the people on the upper management level. So your presentation skills or your data storytelling skills should reach anyone in the industry. So let's say it should cater the needs of management, and at the same point, even a layman who doesn't even know what a data is, he should be understanding what you're speaking. So that is more important in such a way.
So as someone who works in data science, can you give some tips to people who want to get into the field? Perhaps they want to get into the field of data storytelling, or into the field of trying to understand development issues for data science. So what is the most important thing to remember if you want to work in data science?
Mm-hmm. Well, as I said in my recent interview to the AI Time Journal,
mm-hmm.
it's about practice, patience, and persistence. So mm-hmm. no matter what your background is, once you are into data science, learn new things. So life is all about learning new stuff. So take for example, I'm really good at connecting with people. I connect well with people. So mm-hmm. trying to help as many as I can to find a job, or be it venting out their emotions, they used to call me. So if you are really into coding, go for it. So mm-hmm. in my case, I'm really good at connecting with people. So I moved towards the business roles. But for instance, if you are someone who is passionate about coding, take Python or programming, practice it. Practice it daily, like how you, for instance, brush your teeth daily. So it's all about practicing it again and again and every day. So to be honest, that's the only mantra I can think of, someone who is getting into data science.
So you learn it. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, so in my opinion, I would say learn it, master it. If you can't, then find a way. Just try to find an alternative. So there is always one.
So you mentioned that you have this very important role of translating the problems, the business problems into coding and kind of being the link, I guess, between, you know, the data science world and the business world, right? So in that regard, I would like to ask you about the impact data science had on business in recent years. How did the data science change the way we think about business and business problems? Did you observe this change, or are we still observing the potential, in your opinion?
That's indeed a really good question. I mean, like this is where people need to focus. I mean, people from industry and also people, I mean, those who are willing to get into this field. So data science, it actually helps businesses to explore the hidden insights of the data. So for instance, it helps making crucial business decisions across the departments. And for instance, the marketing is also made a lot easier nowadays, since we started focusing more on customer-centric projects. So earlier, it was completely different, but now we started more focusing on customer-centric projects. So for instance, we work at Siemens. We work with solving real-world problems in mobility.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. The data science opens up a lot of opportunities also for personalization, I guess, and scalability. Mm-hmm. So that's something that you touched on. Well, obviously, we cannot avoid coronavirus. That's a very important topic. It affected everybody's life. Again, from your perspective, looking from the business side, do you see a particular role that data science could play in solving the current crisis or helping to solve the current crisis? And do you see any particular application where data science could be important and make a real difference?
It's good that you took this point to the table. I mean, like, I wanted to address this topic as well at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Please be serious, guys. I mean, stay home and stay safe.
Mm-hmm.
Because right now we are in such a situation where everybody needs to contribute to the health and safety of the others. So that is more important. And yeah, coming back to the question, I mean, I could see a lot of COVID dashboards in the recent times. I mean, some of them were really fascinating. So for instance, modeling COVID spread versus the healthcare capacity, that was one dashboard that I saw was really interesting, because it clearly picturizes you the healthcare capacity of each and individual locations. And then there are several corona trajectories that you come across every day. There are even R packages being developed. So if you look at the other side, there are also a lot of research calls and funding calls are also going on. I guess even your institute has also made a funding call, like the Allen.
Yes, we have a DECOVID program. It's called DECOVID. We have a number of calls and we are supporting NHS in their efforts. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as soon as you sent me that invite, I was like just browsing through your profile and found out that you work for that institute. And when I was browsing that, I was able to see that they have a funding call as well. Like same as Ericsson. Ericsson, they do have a research call for COVID people as well.
Mm-hmm. So I would like to broaden the perspective a little bit. So we talked about one specific thing, which is COVID and the research data science and projects and data science associated with COVID. But if we look broader in the next 5 years, what do you think the hot topics will be in data science? What is the future of data science in the next 5 years?
Data, as you know, I mean, data is already everywhere. Data is already termed as the new oil. So I guess the data professionals like me, I mean, we are the least affected ones during such COVID days. So all you need is data and a good internet connection. So most of us are comfortable enough to work in our free spaces. Like most of the data scientists, I am not sure whether they have their services have been interrupted. Yeah, probably some of us might have faced cloud issues, connection to cloud and getting the data. But ultimately, once that is done, we are up and running. We are up and running from any nook and corner of the world. So the one good thing about being a data professional is you can be remote. You can be remotely working. Like even before the corona came into our lives, we were comfortably working in at homes. So I could see data science is one of the booming fields that everybody should look upon, no matter what the field, be it mobility, be it retail, be it pharmaceutical industries. So even I once, I can give you an example. I mean, like I recently read an interview, a blog from Andrew and someone else, I mean, I forgot the name, but they both are from the Data Science Institute of Columbia University.
Mm-hmm.
So they built something that reduced the likelihood of drug discovery failure in a lab. So considering the current situation, these kind of things are really helpful. So for instance, if we invest a lot of time and money in building a drug or developing a drug, it can go horribly wrong. So in that case, such products are always cool and they can give you a quicker solution. I mean, like in a normal case, in an ideal case, if we would have taken 1 to 1.5 years of time to discover a drug for something, then with the help of data science, we can be even quicker.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the things that I can think from a medical perspective.
Mm-hmm. And then in business perspective, maybe kind of broader, you know, broader view, mm-hmm. Do you think we will be, I don't know, into the next stage of AI, into robotics?
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course. I mean, like the next big thing is also Internet of Things, which is always coupled along with the data science. So I could see a future where technology talks more than human beings. Like devices, multiply connected devices, like smart watches, kitchens, smart homes. So n number of devices will be communicating within themselves, and that is gonna get massive as we progress. So there will be tons and tons of massive data, and if you look at things that are in public, everything contributes to this in the future. And we'll be working on a massive amount of data. So from a business perspective, there are looming lot of opportunities in and around data. So I would say this is the right time to get your hands-on experience into this data science domain.
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned the availability of large amounts of data, and we are all concerned about privacy and security. So, and I particularly wanted to ask you about ethics and responsibility. So from a practitioner's perspective, how can one make sure that things are done ethically and responsibly? Because we've seen some really bad examples, right? Like Cambridge Analytica, where, you know, the basic human digital rights were violated. Yeah, so people's data were harvested without the knowledge of the fact, right? So all these things can happen in principle if people are not careful. So from a practitioner's perspective, did you come across any practical tools that would help to actually implement ethics and responsibility in practice, or is it something that we still need to develop?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I agree to this question. I mean, like, I have been through this ethical issues when it comes to data, because it is really important right now, like how we work with the data. So since I also work in Germany, we do have this law which was implemented a couple of years back. It was called GDPR.
So yeah, in the UK it's the same. Yes.
Yeah.
We still so, managed to get it before Brexit.
Yeah, that's the thing, that you got it from us before the Brexit. Yes. So yes, I mean, having with the GDPR, the General Data Protection Regulation, like for the guys that who doesn't know what is GDPR, I'm just explaining. So there are companies that they have set up ethical teams in place, like ethical teams, or call it compliance team or data governance team. So they do have these layers in the organization at the moment. So mm-hmm. we should be knowing which data we should be working on and which not. So which are ethical and which aren't. So we should be clear about what we are using. So as you said, it can be a complete mess if something goes wrong, because it's all about a customer's privacy in terms of location, age, name, and sex. So everything is in the data. So data doesn't mean that it's all about your personal details. It is also about where you travel. Take, for instance, your GPS locations. Sharing it online publicly doesn't gonna help. So you should be really careful about these things when you work on data.
Mm-hmm. So thank you so much for sharing your views today. We came to the last question of the interview, and I always ask everyone the same question, and normally that's the question that the majority of people have a problem with. So the question is tough in the sense that I have imposed a restriction on it. So the restriction is the following. So if you have to name one book and one film that you could recommend to people, what would they be? So the restriction is you can only pick one of each, so you can't like have several.
Okay. I mean, to be honest, I'm not a big fan of books, so to say. So probably I can recommend what others have recommended to me. Is that fine?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. But it also doesn't have to be a data science book. It can be just a book that really inspired you, you know. It doesn't have to be within the field. It can be just a book you read, philosophy, and it inspired you, and you still reread it very often, yeah.
Okay. But probably, I mean, since I'm a data professional, and I hope a lot of data professionals might look at this video, so I'll stick to a data book.
Yes, of course.
Which is from one of my LinkedIn connections. I mean, he's Andriy Burkov. He's a Russian, and he has written a book on 100-page machine learning book. So it's actually really interesting. I haven't gone through the whole book yet, but since a lot of people have also recommended that to me, I have to disclose that book to the audience.
Sounds good. What about film?
I forgot that. Film, what do you say? Probably that Interstellar. I would rate Interstellar as is one of my favorite movies. I mean, it's top-notch when it comes to the imagination level of how far we can go, or how far it can take us through. So, yeah.
So yeah, basically, that's kind of a movie about dreaming big, yeah, and then not being afraid of pursuing your dreams. So it's an excellent choice.
Exactly. Well, that is also what I wanted to tell at the end, because dreaming big is one such thing that most of the Indians, or most of the people, they fail to do. Mm-hmm. So in my opinion, I would tell dream big. So dream big, dream massive, so that it pulls you from anywhere. I mean, whenever you get distracted from the other stuffs, if you dream big, it will pull you from anywhere.
Awesome. So here's a message from Vijay for today. Dream big. That's awesome. So thank you so much, Vijay, for finding the time and for talking to me today. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot, Gana. Thanks a lot. Have a nice day and stay safe and healthy. Let's fight this corona together.